Hey guys, thank you again for listening to the Showdown Podcast. This is our Christmas celebration spectacular, or some bullshit that we called it, and features our second straight episode with Patrick the Blind Guy. We hope you enjoy it, but before we get to that episode, this is the last Showdown Podcast for 2015, so we just wanted to take a second to thank all of you,
every one of you.
Every three of you.
I think give us a little more credit. Say a couple dozen.
Okay, a couple dozen.
A couple hundred followers on Facebook.
We want to say thank you. And we also, of course, want to thank our guests that joined us this year on the show. From Bob East to Mike Whitcliffe to Joe Lavelle to Patrick the Blind Guy, who you're about to hear. And, of course, Brent Terhune, Mr. Turkey himself. Matt Holt and Jeff Vibbert.
I guess an elf on the shelf now.
Oh, yeah. That's for Bob and Tom. Yeah. Funny kid, man. Listen to the Jeff Vibbert podcast, obviously. Check out Matt Holt's Acting My Age on iTunes. Brent Terhune's Mr. Turkey. I'm sure Joe Lavelle will be in a Nouveau contest soon at some point. And Mike Whitcliffe, we wish them the best in their future podcasting endeavors.
Bob East has got a movie coming out sometime. I guess now that it's the end of the year, it'll be the beginning. It'll be sometime in the spring of 2016. Don't quote me on that.
In which you will see both myself and Corey.
Yes, it's called Pit Fires from Hell.
Decided not to get the best actor from the show to be in the movie, huh?
Yeah, I tried. I lobbied for you.
And if you're in Broad Ripple and you see Patrick, buy him a drink or help him maybe cross the street. So
he's not stuck on that corner.
Still the corner.
What do we look forward to in 2016, Corey?
In 2016, we have the normal battles that we've been doing, and so you'll be familiar with that. But we've got some new stuff coming along. Like the Survivor Series. What we're calling the Survivor Series. What we're doing is we're taking an older movie, probably from the 80s or 90s, and we're watching them back and seeing if they either hold up and they're still good, or if they just flat out still suck. Or maybe we changed our minds. Maybe they were sucking, and it's like, it's not really that bad.
We grew up, and suddenly that movie didn't suck anymore.
Yeah. So those will come out in between our normal battles, just to give you something, some more of us to listen to, and to change things up a little bit.
Yep, and we have more special guests coming up this year as well. And
our shorts we're going to be doing?
Our short? You'll see a little commercial from us. We're going to shoot that here probably in January once Christmas time is all over with and we've got time to do it. So that'll be fun.
It'll be a big year for the Showdown Podcast.
Yes. So, again, thanks for listening, and we hope we don't disappoint you in 2016. So
well, you on. Will. We won't.
Yeah, I might.
This has been an award-winning podcast.
Yes, since we are now an award-winning podcast. So, keep listening, and thanks for listening. And here's the next episode with Blind Patrick.
Just say, enjoy the show.
Enjoy the show.
The following podcast contains spoilers and adult language. Listener discretion is advised.
The Showdown Podcast with Corey and Vic. A debate on what movie is better, Corey's choice versus Vic's choice. They each plead their case and try to destroy the others. It's a combat of subjective opinion. I'm Brad Scott, your impartial judge, and as always, my say is final.
The Showdown Podcast presents the Patrick the Blind Guy Memorial Holiday Celebration Spectacular episode featuring Patrick the Blind Guy. Today's combatants, Corey, I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas Miller and his film Scrooged, and his opponent, How the Vic Stole Christmas Miller and his film Bad Santa, featuring your host, Brad Scott. Let us prepare to podcast.
Hello.
Welcome to the Showdown Podcast. It is our holiday celebration spectacular slash Patrick the Blind Guy memorial episode.
I'm still alive.
Oh, that's fantastic. All right, welcome to the show. It is our holiday episode. This is our second annual holiday episode, right?
It is.
Yeah, last year we had Christmas Story versus Ernest Saves Christmas, and Ernest got robbed because he was, you know what, I felt like it was a little bit of persecution because Ernest was just trying to keep Christ in Christmas. So, welcome to the show. We are once again joined by Patrick the Blind Guy. Patrick, welcome back to the show.
Thank you.
We appreciate you making the long trek for for a second episode. Really surprised that you made it since you drove. But we have some good holiday movies today. We have Scrooged versus Bad Santa, and Corey, go ahead and call it.
You want me to call it, or?
Yeah, you call it.
Okay, alright, I'll call it. Heads.
Heads? Siri, flip a coin.
It's tails this time.
Alright, so Vic, the black man finally won.
It's amazing.
So
on a phone at that.
We could have called this Black Christmas episode.
Honestly, I thought you could have used that for his nickname, but we'll move on.
I like how the Vic stole Christmas.
Yeah, it turned out to be better.
Yeah. Plays off stereotype.
We'll leave the creative fest second.
Although I will say that, I mean, since we are a geeky podcast, we probably should stop playing off of black stereotypes and bitches at Walmart. It's really holding back the integrity of our award-winning podcast.
Can we ever say that with a straight face?
No.
It just goes to show you that if a podcast isn't listened to in a forest, it can still win an award.
Hell
so,
yes.
Vic, you get to choose. Are you going to go first or are you going to defer?
I'm going to go first.
All right. So tell us about Bad Santa.
All right, so Bad Santa is a dark Christmas comedy about a crotchety-ass old grifter named Willis T. Stokes, played by Bob Thornton.
If you were going to go with a dark Christmas comedy, I thought you would have gone with Tyler Perry Presents Madea's Christmas.
That's a little too literal, even for my black ass.
Okay, I'm sorry, go ahead.
And his partner, Marcus. So there is a black guy involved in this storyline. Two very good black actors, by the way, played by Tony Cox, who reunite once a year in order to rip off different shopping malls and things, acting as Santa Claus and his elf. They basically case the place during the week. They work as Santa and his little elf to figure out the best ways to rob the place. Christmas Eve rolls around. They rip the places off after everybody's left, since everybody's so busy going on their Christmas holiday. And since the place isn't, no one's there the next day, no one notices what's happened until after everybody comes back from the holiday. So in this world, people actually get the holidays off. So that's a great thing.
You know what? Let's talk about that real quick. There is a big uproar, especially I think past few years, with stores that are now opening earlier and earlier. And a lot have started to open on Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
What are your guys' thoughts?
It's bullshit.
It is bullshit. I say whatever. I don't work within the public service like that anymore, so I don't care. But
when you did?
But when I did, you know what?
It wasn't bullshit, right?
No, you know what?
It's the nature of the beast.
The way I see it is, yes, they're opening because they want to make money, and that's all they care about. Yes, that's true. But there are some people that don't have family to go to, and they don't want to spend time with their family. So if they want to do that, if they want to work that, that's, you know, an option for them.
And however, that's not an option to the people who work with them that are then, because those people are around and say, oh, I don't care, I don't want to be with my family, then the retailers are then going, oh, well, nobody needs to be with their families for the holiday. Like, the holidays are not a commercial thing, never have been for my family. And the more this happens, the more it becomes nothing more than a commercial thing. It's less about family and the actual spirit of the holidays.
Do you have to work holidays?
I do.
Okay, this is interesting because I'm actually I'm who Corey's talking about. I have a family, obviously. I have a daughter I love more than anything. But I don't
do a whole lot of like family get together type things. Mm-hmm. I actually get uncomfortable in a lot of those environments. And I used to love when I was at Best Buy and I would work Memorial Day, any holiday, because I would get paid 8 hours. No, I'd get paid 8 hours whether I was there or not.
Right.
Then if I am there, I get time and a half on top of the 8 I've already made. So I'm basically working, I'm getting 2.5 days of hours. Mm-hmm. Inside of working one shift.
But did they have that rule you had to work the day before and the day after? Because that's one of the tricks they do. To
depends. Depends on the holiday.
Yeah.
And it depends, I think, on whether you're full or part-time. But I would always work those days as well.
Yeah. They are sneaky like that.
Yeah, they are.
And my thing is...
They're like, oh, you thought you were going to make that money, but you didn't work the day before, so you don't get it.
Sorry.
And here's the thing. The problem is you have a large group of people who are so upset that these people have to work... You know, on the holidays, but they're telling them how upset they are about it as they're shopping on the holidays. Exactly. Those are the worst people in the world. You know,
I'm so sorry you have to be here today.
You know, I can't believe they're making you guys work today. By the way, the sign said that was only $14.99, right. So I'm going to need you to get a manager, even though there's 1,400 people in this line. I'll probably go up to customer service and do this later. I want to do it now because I want to go spend time with my family, like you should be able to do. And yeah, can I go ahead and get that 20 cash back in 2 tips, please?
And while I agree with what Vic is saying, and I totally understand, I can totally relate to Brad some more.
Are you one of those guys out there on...
I have been known to go out on Black Friday, yes.
There is something, like, kind of magical and fun about going... Now, listen, that's to me the one argument I could get behind for why it's ruining, is I think... I remember... years ago, I used to get excited to wake up at 3 in the morning on Black Friday, you know, and there were times I'd have a little flask and have me a couple of shots and, you know, me and a couple of buddies would go hit up, you know, wait in line at Best Buy and try to get some cheap Christmas. That was fun. That, to me, is the tradition that's being taken away.
Yeah. Yeah. As somebody that, again, as somebody that doesn't work retail, that's when I started doing it, when they were still doing it. We open at 4 a.m., you know, the day after Thanksgiving.
But they were giving, but this is the thing, like, that's acceptable. One, because they've literally given the people the holiday. And I'm okay with that. When that was the tradition for Black Friday, that was fine to me because you had separation of church and state. They got to spend the day with their families, whatever, and then they go in early in the morning, that's fine.
But no, you kind of don't, because what you don't get is that we had to go in the night before anyways to set up. For Black Friday.
This is true. But you still had more time. Because I worked at Target during Black Friday in my past. I used to work electronics and I used to do stock. And that was a bitch. Because during that holiday, that's how it was. But we usually did our setup because they actually, when I worked at Target, they were closed during, on Thanksgiving. But we went in the day before Thanksgiving and we set everything up and had everything in place. So that all you was to do is just bring it out, throw it up, and you're ready to go. And that's when, like, that was right about the time where they were like, fuck, putting it on shelves, just bring the pallet out, set it down, put a thing on it. That's what it was. And that wasn't that bad. I still got the amount of time that I wanted. I still got to sit down, watch the football game, have dinner, have time with my family. And then, yeah, I had to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and go in. But the people that usually volunteered, that's the ones he's talking about. I don't have a family. I don't feel like I might as well make the money. Those are the ones that volunteered to go in and do that preset.
Real quick, before we get back to Bad Santa... What is your Christmas Day tradition with your family?
We actually, now that my kids are older, our tradition is at midnight, so 12:01, that's when we celebrate Christmas.
No. I mean, what's your Christmas Day tradition?
Sleeping. Now.
What did you tell us earlier was your Christmas Day tradition? What are you going to do this year as part of your Christmas Day tradition?
Oh, we're going to fucking movie.
And you know what's amazing? That they give you guys a key... To go do that so that you guys can let yourselves into the movie theater, start up the popcorn, get the projector going so that none of the movie theater employees have to be away from their families on the holidays.
You are correct.
To service the Miller family who has to see Krampus 3 weeks late because...
Who else said they were going on movies on Christmas?
But I don't give a shit because I'm okay with them making time and a half.
Yeah, exactly. But it's not necessarily the fact that you're against it. But again, I know the people who work at my movie theater, and those motherfuckers, they're doing it because they don't want to be home. There are people who volunteer. Like you said, I used to be one of those people who would volunteer to go in and do it because I wanted to make the money and I knew there wasn't anything happening. But one thing that has not changed is the movie industry has always been an open on holidays thing. This isn't something that they're just trying to make money off of and capitalizing on. They've always done that. That's one of the biggest business days for the movie industry and the theater industry is during the holidays.
He just was a Southern Baptist preacher on me. He contacted the Holy Ghost.
I'm about ready to start dancing in the aisle.
So, okay. I'm sorry. Continue. Okay. That's it. Where was I? They are basically planning on robbing this mall for everything that they have. They plan on taking the deposits. They plan on taking merchandise. They're just going to rob them blind. It's something they've been getting away with for years, and every year they get back together and do it again. The problem with it is this time is Billy Bob Thornton's character, Willie, is depressed, disgruntled, and has become a sex addict during his year off from, you know, being a Santa. And Tony Cox, who plays his, like I said, his elf, who is a little person of black descent, plays his elf, and he is...
He's a black midget.
Exactly. I don't know now, dude.
I was kind of confused myself.
Was he blind?
In the movie, he actually refers to himself as a motherfucking dwarf.
Now, what was Billy Bob Thornton's character's name?
Willie T. Stokes.
So, now we know that I have all these like weird facts that I just have in my head. Did you guys actually know Bill Murray was signed to be Willie?
Yes.
But ended up dropping out for Lost in Translation.
And do you know who else also was signed up for that? Jack Nicholson.
Ooh.
Both of them actually were going to play we're going to play him, but because of other contractual obligations, decided not to do it.
So we have Billy Bob Thornton, mm-hmm. who we've seen the body of work with the film. But do you think Murray or Jack Nicholson would have been better?
Better?
Mm-hmm. For the role. In the role.
I don't think Murray would have been better. I think Nicholson could have pulled off one hell of a Willie T. Stokes. Because you can see Jack Nicholson in his other body's work. You've seen dirty, grungy, down and out Jack Nicholson. Not so much with Bill Murray. You've seen him like playing that, but he's just, I think his comedic side would have probably shown out so much more that he would have come off a lot funnier than this rather than just down and dirty. To me, that's how I feel about it. Another interesting fact about that, I don't know if you know this, but he was not, Billy Bob Thornton was nominated for a Golden Globe Award for this movie, and he lost it to Bill Murray for Lost in Translation. So he's kind of probably hating Bill Murray about this movie situation at the moment. But to go on, the story progresses as Santa...
Real quick, because we're still on set. Do you know Larry David was also considered for the role of Willie?
That I did not.
Wow.
Now, could you imagine...
Larry David, that's the guy from...
Curb Your Enthusiasm. And yeah. He was the co-creator of Seinfeld, and actually the basis of the character of George.
I would not have liked him as that character. Mm-hmm. I don't think I could have seen him as that character. You think so?
Well, that's catchphrase from Curb Your Enthusiasm.
No, I don't watch it.
One of the best shows of all time.
Really?
Oh, did you like Seinfeld?
No.
Black people don't like Seinfeld, do they?
I don't know a lot to do. To be honest,
I don't know. I feel like I feel like Seinfeld should be universal, but I notice a lot of black people don't like it, and there was also criticism that there weren't a whole lot of black people on Seinfeld.
There aren't.
But you're forgetting about Ralph Harris, who was the delivery guy with an itchy sweater in an episode.
I have seen several episodes of him.
One.
I've seen several episodes, and I really, I believe that. I don't know why that is. I'm going to ask
you. I agree, though. I think Larry David would have been fourth on that roster in that role.
Honestly, I could see Bill Murray playing it.
What order would you put him in, then?
I think Nicholson first because, again, just he has more of the grittier old man type.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would have to obviously see his version of the character, but then I'd probably put Bill Murray as my second then Billy Bob, and then Larry David. But I'm not a big Billy Bob fan, which is probably a little bit of bias on my part.
I kind of like him too, so I think that's why he would be my second too.
Yeah,
but I do think that Nicholson would have done a much better version of Willie T. Neal Stokes. So where was I? Okay, so Marcus is obviously more so the brains behind the operation and kind of the driving force behind this criminal activity. And he's kind of taken the wheel because Willie has just fallen off the fucking wagon and he can't figure out what the fuck he wants to do. He's just unpredictable and I keep wanting to call him Tony. Marcus sees that as dangerous to what they're trying to do because he's going to get them caught. Because he keeps doing stupid shit, like running off and fucking chicks in the ass in store in changing rooms and drawing attention from the mall manager, who then goes to undoubtedly one of my favorite actors in the world, Bernie Mac, who plays a dude by the name of Jin. Yeah, exactly. And the late, great Bernie Mac. And goes and complains to the security manager that he doesn't like this Santa because he's an asshole and he's too gruff and he curses a lot and all this other crap. He's played by the manager is played by I can't remember his name.
John Ritter.
John Ritter.
Vic, talk about a serious misstep in your argument. You forgot the name of the fucking great John Ritter. John Ritter is one of the most underrated comedic actors. That guy was so fucking funny.
Mm-hmm.
He was. However, not remembering his name is not unlike my character when it comes to remembering people's names. So it's not for a lack of respect. It's just I have a hard time remembering people's names. But
and I am the name dropper.
Exactly. And yes, you are. I'm surprised you didn't bring up Jack Nicholson. but he reports to his security officer, Jin Slagley. I don't know where they came up with these names, but they cracked me up. That he's a problem. So he starts investigating after Willie to see what's going on and realizes that these guys are a bunch of con artists and he's going to figure out what they're doing. So he starts tracking down all the crap that they've been up to, ends up searching his room and everything at the hotel. And he figures out that he is just a con man. One of the funny scenes in it is when he drives up to his hotel room. There's a prostitute outside of his house, outside of his room. And he's like, hey, come here. And the prostitute's like, no, last time I messed around with you, I couldn't shit right for a week. And he's like, I don't want that. Just come here. Who's in my room? And she's like, I don't know. Some guy's in there. So the movie is full of just like the raunchiest, most ridiculous, funniest-ass conversations. A point where they get into an argument with Bernie Mac about being just obnoxious and rude. And they basically corner Bernie Mac. They corner Bernie Mac into a conversation, and he starts going off on them like he's just as bad as they are, which is kind of funny. But they also race bait the mall manager into keeping their job because he's going to fire them. And Willie T. Stokes basically confuses the mall manager into making racial comments about black dwarfs. They rip him a new one, and he's like, you know what? Never mind. Let's just forget we had this conversation. So it's hilarious. Through the course of the whole thing, he meets this little kid whose name is Thurman, one of the worst names ever. This kid is just a chubby little kid who's being bullied, and his mom's died. His dad's in jail. He's got a fucked up existence. But he still believes in Santa, and he comes to believe that Willie T. Stokes is actually Santa. And there's one point in which he's talking to him about this, and he's telling him that he wants this pink stuffed elephant for Christmas, which is, if you're going to ask Santa for something, pink stuffed elephant's probably not going to be the thing I ask for. When my mom's died, my dad's in jail, and I'm living with my senile ass grandma, who's played by, was it Cloris Leachman? Am I right? Look at that. I remember the name. Motherfucker, I'm on a roll.
Finally got one.
So
He takes the kid. The kid helps him out too, as much as he believes he's Santa Claus, and it's actually helping the kid to be happy during the holidays. When he starts getting accosted by people, the kid actually steps in and stops this dude from picking on Willie T. Stokes.
Who plays the kid?
His name is
that Brett Kelly.
Yes.
Yes.
So wait, this movie came out in 2003, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's the little fat kid, right?
Yeah.
Right.
But it says he was born in 72?
That kid was born in 72?
There's no way.
On Flixster?
There's no
way. No, he's born in 93. They're totally wrong.
Birthday, October
30th,
1973.
29th, 1972. Did they show a picture of that kid on that?
Ontario, Canada. His picture is actually him and Billy Bob Thornton in the boxing.
It's wrong.
Yeah, someone really fucked that up.
Because even the city, because IMDb has him listed as being born in Vancouver.
Because the internet never lies.
Right. He's the same kid from Unaccompanied Minors too. He plays a pretty good. He plays a pretty good character in that.
Oh
also.
Yeah.
He plays what's his name? They call him Beef Welling. His last name is Wellington, so they call him Beef, which is kind of funny. Anyway. he's fucking older than me. At that point, he would be older than me during that same time frame. So he befriends this kid, and more so out of necessity than actually being a nice guy, because he needs somewhere to hide out. And after talking to this kid and giving him a ride home and figuring out where he lives, he ends up going back to this kid to hide out when he figures out that Bernie Mac is onto him. Along with that, Bernie Mac figures out what they're doing and confronts them about it and actually tells them, if you guys want to get away with this, you're going to give me half of whatever the fuck you get out of this. And I'm going to pick what it is. I want half the money and I want half the goods. And Marcus gets pissed off at that. He's like, look, I'll give you money, but you're not getting the products, because the products is everything him and his wife want, more so than the money. And Bernie Mac's like, this ain't no fucking Chinese food. You ain't ordering by numbers. I'll take what I want. So Marcus gets pissed off at this too and basically kills Bernie Mac to get rid of him. So their interactions throughout the movie are pretty funny. There's another point in there where Bernie Mac tells him to drag Billy Bob Thornton to the car. And he's like, motherfucker, I'm a dwarf. In what way do you think I'm going to be able to drag this dude out to the car? And he's like, he starts messing with him. And he's like, I need a forklift or something to move this motherfucker. He's like, it's physics. It's not genetics. It's physics. I am a dwarf. I can't move this guy out of the building. What the hell do you want me to do? So he moves on. When Billy Bob Thornton actually kind of comes to this epiphany that he's just done with life. He wants to die. He wants it to be over with. So he, you know, starts up a car, runs a pipe in, starts deep, breathing deeply. But in the interim, he also doesn't want to leave this kid without knowing, you know, what kind of person he was and that this isn't his fault. So he leaves a note that explains everything to the kid and explains to everybody all the crap he's pulled over the years. But when the kid walks up to him, he's sitting in the car, he's got a black eye, and he feels really bad because this kid is really going through it, and he wants to help him, so he decides not to kill himself. Try to help this kid through the holidays, and he tries to teach him how to box, which this kid has no skill at it whatsoever. And he also decides that, you know, I'm just going to get through this shit, get it over with, and be done with it. But he still gave that fucking note to the kid. And the kid, being so gullible and sweet, doesn't think anything about the fact that he just turned it in, when he turns it into the cops, that this is going to get the guy that he thinks is Santa Claus caught. And he goes, they go about, Christmas Eve rolls around, they rob the place, they're getting all the shit together. He thinks about the fact that this kid, all he really wants for Christmas is his pink stuffed elephant. So he runs to go get the pink stuffed elephant for him. When he comes back, Marcus actually tells him, you know what, I'm tired of your bullshit. We're going to kill you and take your part of this also and be out. And when that all comes down, that's also when the cops actually figure out what's going on from this letter and surround the mall, knowing that they're in there to try to stop them from committing this crime, because the kid handed in the letter from Santa to the police department. Marcus decides, fuck this, I ain't going down. He starts shooting at the cops. Fucking Willie goes, fuck this, I'm not getting killed. He runs for it. They chase him down, but the reason he's running for it is not to actually get away. He has this I'm going to be a better person moment, and he runs straight for the kid's house, Thurman, to give him this stuffed animal before he goes to jail. He gets blown away out in front of the kid's house by the cops, who basically shoot Santa for Christmas, which has got to be harmful to everybody involved. And that's the end of the story, except that he survives. And he tells everybody what happens, and you find out that the chick he's been banging, Laura Graham, who's a Santa groupie, becomes the kid Thurman's surrogate mom, so that solves his mommy issues, and the fact that this senile-ass grandmother is taking care of this kid and apparently letting him run around with creepy-ass old guys all over the place, getting in the cars. No one's taught this kid it's you shouldn't get in the stranger's cars. Like, there's a whole nother storyline behind that. Marcus and his wife end up in prison. Unfortunately, he ends up in the same prison that the kid's dad's in, so he has to get warned off of him. Because the cops shot Santa for Christmas, they actually don't. They kind of go lenient on Willie T. Stokes for because they were embarrassed, obviously, for blowing away Santa for Christmas on this kid's porch. So he actually gets away with not being. He actually gets a lesser sentence for a Merry Christmas miracle happens, and he gets kind of out of trouble. So
it's a Christmas miracle. When I used to play free poker at my cousin's little bar poker league, there was like 2 years in a row where I just got hammered on, I think it was either Christmas Eve or the day before Christmas Eve or something. And I would just annoy everyone playing poker by just yelling. Anytime somebody would say anything to me, a waitress would bring me a beer, I'd just look and go, "It's a Christmas miracle!"
Logistics for this thing, like I said, we talked about already. I had some points like we brought up about the other people that were playing the character. Again, it's, you know, there's a lot of Christmas music in this also. Which I'm not really a person that enjoys Christmas music on a general basis, like just to sit there and listen to it like my family does. But the way that they used it and how they scored it into the movie was actually pretty entertaining. It gave me my full of Christmas music for the entire season, so I'm done. It's 78% fresh rating on Rotten Tomatoes. It actually made some really good money considering what it was up against. I mean, it's a good movie. I enjoy the movie.
Favorite Christmas song ever, Corey?
Oh God, White Christmas.
Little Drummer Boy.
Little Drummer Boy.
Little Drummer Boy.
Surprise! The black man going with the drums.
The rumble pum pum motherfucker.
I'm pointing at you, Patrick. I guess you didn't see me.
No, I did not. Jingle Bells.
Right, sticking with the classic?
Yeah.
Well, you're all wrong.
Why not?
Best Christmas songs ever are Happy Xmas, probably the best. John Lennon.
It's Christmas in Hollis, Queens.
Ooh, right, that's up there. Please Come Home for Christmas.
I didn't want to get too stereotypical.
The Eagles version.
That's actually pretty good.
That's the song that you can only listen to on Christmas if you're sitting alone in a bar with a cup of whiskey in front of you after some just horrible life experience. And you're wearing a Carhartt jacket.
You came home and your wife, all the presents are gone. The tree is stripped but still there and your kids are gone.
I like Christmas in Hollis too.
Yeah, that's a great movie. I love that movie. I love that song. The movie. I love that song. And the video is hilarious.
Yeah,
fucking video cracks me up because there's so much stereotypical shit and it's ridiculous. But you do, look, coming from somebody who was born in Jamaica, Queens, which is literally right next to Hollis, Queens, that song was like the anthem in New York in our area. Like, because obviously Run DMC's from Hollis. But like, the stereotypes they put into it, like, are questions that, like, little urban kids actually ask. Like, how the fuck does Santa get into our apartment when we live on the 25th floor and there's no fucking chimney and there's bars on all the windows and the doors are, like, triple dead bolted. How does he get in here?
I tell you what, that
nigga
did some time. You ain't learned about that shit unless you've been in the pen.
Santa really is a black man.
That
nigga
been to jail.
Exactly.
By the way, You should explain, because I don't want people to not... Because sometimes when I listen to the show, I confuse your my voice. That's Vic. He's basically my mouthpiece if I want to use the N-word. So
if he wants to drop an N-bomb, I drop it for him. He pushes the button.
Yeah, you hear that word. It's coming from Vic.
It's more of a visual joke.
until the series finale of the showdown when I accidentally say it myself.
And I come across
and
the
Vic
table.
And murders me. And the showdown is no more.
Now, did you watch... You watched Bad Santa, not yes. Bad or Santa.
Which is basically just the unrated version.
It's the unrated version.
It's more fucks, because this movie did set the record for profanities in a Christmas movie. And
I can believe that.
I'm not surprised.
It could be why the New York Times said... it's the evil twin of Miracle on 34th Street, and it flamed Disney for allowing such beloved figures as Santa Claus to be trashed by a Miramax subsidiary.
Now,
nice.
Personally, I don't think I've seen Bad Santa, and that's basically the director's cut, if you will. I've seen Bad Earth Santa, which is the studio's version. It's their cut, and I guess Terry Zwigoff did not have any input on that. But I like the studio's version better. It is so much more funny than the other version. And it's... I don't know. I guess I said I hadn't really seen Bad Santa, but I think Badder Santa just... It's just downright hilarious, and a lot of the a lot of the F-bombs. There's a lot more cussing.
Wait, did you just say you haven't seen Bad Santa? You've seen Badder Santa.
Yeah.
Bad Santa is...
I've seen it.
Studio's version, right?
Yeah.
And you said that it's better
than
the movie that you actually saw.
No, I said it's better than Bad Santa, the director's version of it.
Badder Santa is the director's version.
No, but Bad Santa is the director's version.
Okay, so here's what happened. Bad Santa was the original movie.
Right.
The editor's version of the movie, he just didn't take the shit out that she couldn't.
No,
put
no,
on
I understand
thing,
that.
So
I'm saying I believe what he just
yeah.
said.
The
was...
studio's version is better than the director's version, which I have seen on like Comedy Central.
Bad Santa?
Yeah.
So you thought the Comedy Central version was
yeah.
better than the version you
no,
actually
no, no,
watched?
No, no, no.
Badder Santa?
No, I thought Badder Santa was better.
Well, of course, you were watching it on.
He just said the studio's version is better than the director's version.
Right.
The studio version is the one on Comedy Central.
No, that's the director's
what?
Version.
What?
That's the director's
just story. Let it go. Like, we're not gonna. It's I understand. I
you get what I'm saying, right?
Yes, I hear you.
Bad Santa, the one he's talking about, is the director's
the
version.
The one that you were supposed to watch for the Showdown podcast.
Badder Santa is the studio's version. That one is a better film. I've seen Bad Santa.
It's the same fucking
no, it's
movie.
Not. They
except
alternate.
It's got a couple extra scenes.
It's altered and it just.
I know, but what
the,
you were saying was
is,
you were saying the
different.
Studio's version is better than the director's.
That's
version.
Correct. Why?
Because you're saying one instance you're saying that Badder Santa is better than Bad Santa.
Correct.
But you're also saying that Bad Santa, which is the studio version,
Bad Santa
is better than the
that's
director's
you're being
version.
Confused. I should get like a chalkboard.
Which one is the studio version?
Badder.
Okay, because 2 minutes ago I clarified that and you said yes, the
no,
studio version is
confused.
The one on Comedy Central. Did I not say that, Vic?
You're getting confused.
No, you were confused.
No.
He's confused.
He is.
Patrick's confused.
Yes.
This whole damn court is blind. I mean, confused. No, you said it fucked up. We're going to listen to it after we're done.
All right.
Continue. That's,
all right.
This is horrible radio.
I'm talking about finding a little black midget. A small, colored, African-American small person.
Hold on, you know what?
What?
Yes. Nigga?
Please. God damn it, man. From now on,
I couldn't get it out.
I'm pointing at you. First context is you say that word.
Oh, you got it.
And if it's not supposed to be that, and I'm pointing you for another reason, it'll be funnier
you
to you.
You pointed me all the time, I wasn't sure.
But from now on.
I thought he was pointing at me.
Yeah.
Two fingers, all right.
Two fingers. Do you understand my
minute?
There we go, all right. So, continue.
I wasn't sure.
All
right. I got confused. It's because of your ass, motherfucker. Your ass did this to me on
good.
Holiday.
Good. So are you finished?
I don't think I am, actually. I believe that my Rotten Tomato rating was 78%. Certified Rush. Mm. Fresh, glorious ride and gleefully offensive black comedy. Bad Santa isn't for everyone, but Grinches will find it fucking funny just like you did.
You know what they say? The blacker the berry, the resher the juice.
All right, so are you done now?
I'm done.
All right, just had to get that Rotten Tomatoes thing.
That's right.
All right.
All right, so Corey,
and the fact that I made a lot more money than your movie.
Your movie is Scrooged.
My movie is Scrooged. It is a modern retelling of the classic Dickens tale, Scrooge. Bill Murray.
It's actually called A Christmas Carol.
Whatever.
Again, just shitty homework. But I'm impressed. But yeah,
you want to borrow my notes? No. That might help you.
I think he was taking the notes as you were. He wants to look prepared.
Yes, I'm actually prepared for this one. As I said, this is a great modern retelling with Bill Murray.
Exactly what it says on the screen.
I wrote that down. So anyway, Bill Murray does play the Scrooge character, and he is just downright. This is a character that he's never played before, and by character I mean something that he's just downright evil. Okay, you guys done there? Bill is
all right. What did I miss?
We're taking blind selfies. For those of you who don't know,
there too.
Patrick and I have a tradition of when he comes out to watch the open mic comedy shows at Crackers Comedy Club in beautiful Broadway Pool, Indiana. After the show, I give him a lift home and I take a selfie with him in the elevator without him knowing it. Call them blind selfies.
And you're doing selfies.
So why is there always this awkward pause and silence?
I can smell you.
I smell that phone.
My other senses
smell it 30 feet away. That's actually a line from a book of Eli.
All right, so Bill Murray in this role, he just plays a downright evil person.
He's Scrooge.
Yeah, basically. Yeah.
I will say, I have always thought Scrooge was a very misunderstood character.
He's the guy. Scrooge is the guy that didn't have family, so he wanted to work.
Yeah, yeah. He's the guy that Vic is all shitty at as he's walking into his movie theater that he's happy is open on Christmas Day.
Yeah. So, I mean, this is something you haven't seen out of Bill Murray before in any other role, where he is just a downright dick. At one point, he takes a cab that an old lady hailed and jumps in, and as he's driving away, he's flipping her off and laughing at her while she's crying. I mean, he's just perfect in this role. You have Bobcat Goldthwait, who gets fired at the beginning for saying something, or saying that he didn't like a trailer for their Scrooge live adaptation that was going to air on Christmas Eve. And so Bobcat loses his wife and his home, and he becomes a drunk, and by the end of the movie ends up trying to kill Bill Murray's character. But that's jumping a little ahead. You also have Bill Murray's real brother playing his brother in this movie. Now, if you don't really know who that is, he didn't really make... He had, I think, maybe one or two movies in the 80s, but never hit it big.
Which one?
Bill Murray's brother. I forget what his name is.
Well, because, actually, I'm going to get to that.
I'm going to get to his other brother. He's got two brothers in this movie. But his other brother plays his dad in the past when what are you going to say? Okay.
I was just going to say, the difference between your facts that you happen to know off the top of your head and mine, or mine are a little more in-depth than that. Factually accurate. He has three brothers that are in this movie. Their names are John, Joel, and Brian Doyle.
Who was the third? Where was the third one at? I didn't see him.
The facts don't give me that.
Oh, okay.
I can only give you what the facts
give. Facts being IMDb.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Okay. You also And I'm going to continue on with some of the other characters that you've seen here. Buster Poindexter plays the Ghost of Christmas Past. He's great in this movie. I had no idea that he, when the first time I ever saw this movie, that he was even a musician. I thought he was great in this character. I thought he was totally an actor and not a musician, but he's a musician turned actor. And he's just great. You also had Alfre Woodard, who plays. She plays his secretary, and when he goes back in the past, or not, I'm sorry, when the Ghost of the Christmas Present shows him what's going on with her, he sees the home life that she has, and that it's not great, and that she's a single mom with four kids, and they're struggling to get by. So he's, at this point, he's starting to change a little bit. He's starting to get the old bit of himself back. And when Buster Poindexter, the Ghost of Christmas Past, takes him in the past, you see the way he used to be. You see that he had a good side. This was before he became the head of this TV studio. And you could see where he started to change. When he started to change was when he got offered to go to dinner at the studio exec's house, and his girlfriend said, "I can't do it." He's like, "Well, I'm going." And he had a good life with her. They were happy, and that's broke it off. And as Bill Murray's current character version is seeing this, he's realizing how stupid he was and that he shouldn't have done that. So when he goes back into the present, he wakes up and goes back into the present. He goes to visit her and is trying to make amends, and he begins to. She's working at a homeless shelter, and one of the side characters that we see is Mama Petrelli from The Goonies, and she is great in this movie. She's so funny in just the 5 minutes that she's in on screen. And as I said, Brian Doyle Murray plays his dad in the past. And which I thought was a funny little nod. And you get to see how he was growing up. His dad was basically a total dick. He was basically him. And he related a lot to his mom. And he had a better relationship with his mom than he did with his dad. Then the Ghost of Christmas Present shows up. As I said, they end up seeing Alfre Woodard's family and what they're going through. Carol Kane plays the Ghost of Christmas Present, and she's great. She was great through the 80s. You really haven't seen much of her lately, except she has just recently showed up on the show Gotham as the Penguin's mom.
Who's that?
Her name is Carol Kane.
Oh, no, Carol Kane is great. Yes. She's hilarious. She played Alan's receptionist mother on Two and a Half Men, who he ends up sleeping with after eating some brownies.
Oh, okay.
I questionable.
She always talks like this. Yeah.
I had such a crush on her when I was younger. And then she was.
Tell
also,
us more about the 40s, Corey. Okay. In her age.
Would you like to hear that? It's kind
of
funny.
Quick, I do want to point out, you're kind of starting to look like the Ghost of Christmas Present here.
That is a Unabomber. What the other?
She takes him to his brother's apartment where they're having their Christmas get together, and obviously he's not there because he's working. And his brother wishes he could be there, but obviously he can't be because he'd rather be working. They're playing Trivia Pursuit, and I thought this was kind of funny. One of the answers to Trivia Pursuit is the Addams Family, which Carol Kane, as she's staying there, she eventually ends up in the movie Addams Family, which I thought was kind of funny. Anyway, he thinks that he was supposed to get his brother, I believe, it was like a blanket or something really cheap. And it turned out he ended up getting his brother a VCR, and a top-of-the-line VCR. And so he was a little mad by that, but at the end of the movie, he was like, you know what, I don't even care. It's perfectly fine. After going to
the... Wait, who got the VCR?
His brother.
He got his brother a VCR?
Yeah. Top of the line VCR,
and his
because he didn't do the buying. It was the secretary that did the buying, and
he was pissed that she spent so much money.
Yeah, he didn't want to spend that much money, And when he finally...
Oh, Bill Murray was shitty. I thought you were saying his brother was shitty.
No.
No, it's his storytelling that's shitty. That's the problem. So, okay. This movie, like, has its moments as far as it being just literally a retelling the same fucking story we've all heard a million times. All through our childhood and up to this point.
It's a modern retelling.
It's the same story, is my point. There are so many other Bill Murray movies that were so much better and so much more entertaining than this particular movie.
Were they Christmas movies?
Doesn't need to be a Christmas movie. Yeah, I'm just saying, in general, you said that this was his one of his best characters ever. And I'm saying that there are tons more characters out there that he played that were a lot better.
I said he hasn't played a character like this because
he's
so evil. Yeah.
Groundhog's Day?
Yeah, he wasn't.
He's a dick.
He was a dick. He was a dick.
He was a dick in Caddyshack. Big dick in Caddyshack.
And Caddyshack, no, he was like a doofus.
He was a dick.
He was a doofus and just had to blow things up.
He was a dick in Ghostbusters, just a funny one.
No.
My point is
I was thinking that, honestly, when he said that earlier. He was kind of a dick in Ghostbusters.
Yeah, he is classically a dick in almost everything he does, but he's so funny at it that it literally defines him. And he's doing it again here, which does not make it a bad movie.
Wasn't he kind of a dick in Stripes, too?
Yeah, he was beyond a dick in Stripes, which undoubtedly is one of my favorite movies.
So anyhow, the Ghost of Christmas Future shows up just in time for him to not be shot by Bobcat Goldthwait's character. And he sees what happens in the future and sees that he thinks that it's his brother that's in this coffin that's about to be burned and... And he realizes it's him, and he doesn't, he's like, no, I can't do it, this can't happen. And he ends up in the box, burning, and then all of a sudden, he's brought back into reality. And through that, he's able to realize what he's done and the way he's been, and that's not the way he needs to be. So he's had this, he's done this total 180 from being that dick in the beginning to saying, you know what, this isn't the way it should be. When he comes back into the present, he actually ends up on stage during the Christmas Carol play and interrupts the whole thing and gives this great speech. And I don't know if it was because I watched this the day after Scott Weiland died, but I about teared up during this speech just because it was so heartfelt and... I don't know if I'm becoming a girl or what, but I was really touched by it. There was one line that he said.
I am shocked that we haven't yet had you record your undying love and tribute to Scott Weiland and how much of an impact he had on you as a filmmaker, especially when it came to Christmas.
Well, he wasn't in any movies.
This is how I feel about it.
Do you have your headphones plugged into it?
No, I don't.
Yeah, a little more difficult than it looks.
All right, where's the noise for his failure?
Think of it. I still might.
Yeah, that was great.
I would
have
killed myself a long time ago.
No more lies.
There was a line that Bill Murray said when he was shown something, and it was something that Bill Murray said as he's Bill Murray's observing his other self, and Bill and his character says something, and it was just really bad. But when he turns to the Ghost of the Future, he says
Ghost of Christmas Future.
Whatever. He says that was a lousy thing to do. Now that line could have been taken one of two ways, either what his other self said, or just the fact that he was shown that. And I think at that point he realized that's when he had been fucking up and that he was taking this whole Christmas thing the wrong way. Again, this movie had funny parts, but all in all, it's a great reimagining of a classic tale.
It's commercial time! All right, Corey, tell the people where they can find you.
You can find
Shut up. Patrick, where can the people find you?
They can find me at a crosswalk trying to get across that damn street.
All right, Corey. Holiday spirit. We always let our guests go first, but why don't you lead us out of the show now, Pat? Go ahead. Corey, where can the people find you?
All right, you can find me.
You idiot. Vic, where can the people find you?
Falls for it every time. You can find me at MillerKing51 on social media, as well as Black and Angry, that's BLAQ, and Angry on Xbox One.
All right. Corey?
I feel like this is a trick.
It is a trick! It's a trick! Brad Scott, you can find me at BradScottComedy.com, at IndieBradScott on Twitter and Instagram. All right, Corey.
You can find me
right after we talk about where the showdown is. It's the Showdown Pod on Twitter and the Showdown Podcast on Facebook. Click like, somebody should.
He swings for that fucking football every
time.
He
really does. Every time. Really you're such a blockhead. Borg! Go ahead.
Twitter and Instagram at NKOGonzo and on Letterboxd.
That wasn't so hard.
What's
it?
I know. I had to say it really fast there.
Why?
Just because I knew he'd try to jump in there.
We're back and ready for the results, but guys, I was thinking. Christmas used to be a time for giving. Now, with stores not even waiting for Black Friday to open their doors, we've become obsessed with material possessions. We have forgotten about the real reason for the holidays. The holidays are a time to gather with friends and family and celebrate just being around each other. I feel like we should use this opportunity to embrace our time together with our Showdown family. We shouldn't consume ourselves with winning and losing. We should just focus on our good company and our good times. So I think in honor of Christmas, you both win.
Yay!
Ha! Just kidding. This is the Showdown. We don't do that. So, Patrick, have you made a decision?
Yes, I have.
All right. And go ahead and tell us who you have picked as a winner and why.
I'm going to go with my personal opinions this round and give Vic the win.
Yes. So Bad Santa.
Bad Santa. I've seen Scrooge once, and I didn't really think it was that funny. Bad Santa, I laugh every time I see it.
So Bad Santa.
Bad Santa.
That's a great opinion.
I will say this. This was difficult. This was. Because I thought one of you should have picked Home Alone. Or Elf. But I like Scrooge.
I actually thought he was gonna pick Elf.
I love Scrooge. I loved it when I was a kid. I was obsessed with Bill Murray when I was a kid. Everything he put out, I was a huge fan of. So I'm gonna give the win to Corey.
Yeah.
Vic, you had a great argument. You were prepared. You were diligent. But I like the movie Scrooge more.
Son of a bitch! Again, you don't understand, Patrick, how often this happens to me with this motherfucker.
And guess what? You just got Scrooged.
You want to reconsider what you just did? Because you're backing this fool.
That was a good pun.
It really did come down to, I love the movie Scrooged. And I felt, honestly, like it was more of an embodiment of Christmas.
This argument?
I know. My reasoning is worse than his argument for the movie. So,
hey, how many times have we had this same conversation? Your argument is the reason why we don't use that as a reason anymore.
I think I've heard this once or twice.
I'm gonna tell you, man.
Hey, I came prepared, and I came with.
And you won with a gimme, or you got it with a gimme.
No,
you
didn't actually win.
We tied. But you tied with a gimme.
But you know what, Vic? You're still my
nigga.
All right. So we have a split decision, which seems appropriate. You're both winners. Sincerely.
Thank you.
Right.
Merry Christmas to you too.
Yeah. Happy Hanukkah. And happy Kwanzaa. So, is it Merry Kwanzaa or Happy Kwanzaa?
It's Happy Kwanzaa.
It's a made-up holiday. It's okay.
It
actually is. It's been around since the 50s.
We are about 2 weeks away from Christmas.
In our world.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's tomorrow. But Let's talk about some Christmas stuff growing up. Does anybody have a special memory or a tradition? We know about yours, Vic, going and you and your family go and talk during movies.
Hold on. Only half of my family, because my wife is white and my kids are half black. So.
Oh, okay. So are your kids whispering through the whole thing?
They just talk, but not loudly.
They just
loudly.
Talk through half the movie.
They talk, but not loudly.
But does anybody else have a Christmas story or tradition?
I can remember...
Oh, what's the one? Go ahead.
I was going to say, I can remember the one time when I was a kid. This was when He-Man, the cartoon, was out, and he had all the toys and everything. And I got Castle Grayskull for Christmas.
This would be a perfect time for a certain soundbite.
Yes. And it was... my parents had taken it out of the box and had left it. I think they had it left it open, because it was one of those things that it was tall. It was maybe, I don't know, 2 feet high, and it would open up, and there was all sorts of stuff on the inside. And
trap
left
doors.
It open. Yeah, they had trap doors and everything. And I came out and saw that and about just shit myself, because that was one of the things I wanted. And then it was like at the time it was a big ticket item too. I don't remember exactly how much, but I remember it being expensive.
I think it was like 50 bones when it first came out.
Yeah.
It wasn't cheap.
One year my mom got me a Lazy Bear. Does anybody remember a Lazy Bear?
From Lazarus?
From Lazarus. The
yes.
Stuff, first of all, do you remember Lazarus?
No.
Well, this was in a lot of the white malls.
Yeah. Well, he was probably in New York at the time. I don't think they were in New York.
So Lazarus was basically like a JCPenney's or a Macy's, and they had this stuffed bear that had like a Santa hat on it, I think, and a scarf, mm-hmm. and it was called the Lazy Bear, and it was like the most popular item when I think I was like probably 4 or 5, so Corey, you were probably in your 30s. But I remember like my mom was like desperately just trying to find one and couldn't find one anywhere, and so like her and my family were trying to pretty much prepare me to not get one, because they didn't want me to be, you know, obviously be really disappointed, because apparently it's like the only thing I asked for. And apparently my mom ended up finding one during the day on Christmas Eve.
She had to fight some guy like Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Oh, fight, bang. I don't know. She's a good mom.
She got it. That's all that matters.
Good mom, Vic.
We don't ask questions.
But I woke up at because I used to sleep, we used to always stay the night at my grandparents' house, and I would sleep in a fold-out couch bed with one of my aunts, Shelly. We'd watch I Love Lucy reruns until I fell asleep. I apparently woke up at like 2 in the morning, saw the Lazy Bear under the tree, went and grabbed it, got it, and went back and went to sleep. So that...
Oh.
Now, do you remember the age when you found out Santa was not real? Hold on. Patrick, you look kind of shitty and devastated. What's wrong? What's going on, buddy?
Wait a second. He's not real?
This is awkward.
You sons of bitches.
Not even the disabled are immune to it.
Fuck
Do you guys remember when you found out? Or do you remember around the time or how you found out? Because I remember how I found out. I was, I think, 9, maybe 10 years old, somewhere around there. Probably 10. And I just remember my mom going, do you know? Like, what do you mean, do I know?
Surprise.
No, she's like, well, I mean, I'm just saying. I know you wanted a Game Boy. Do you want to open it tonight? Or do you know? And I was like, oh, you mean that Santa's not real? Yeah, kids in school clued me into that one. And I ended up, I think that's what I'm going to kind of do with my daughter as well, because that was a good buffer.
Mm.
Because it was like, that was my confirmation. I mean, I had heard.
Find out at school.
I knew, but until your parents tell you, you don't truly know. And her going, okay, he's not real, but how about you open your shit tonight? Like, oh, okay. Yeah. Fuck that fat motherfucker. I wanted those cookies for myself anyways. But what about you?
I don't remember.
Well, I'm sure he... St. Nicholas was probably real when you were.
Yeah. Well, I think he actually died when I was 10. No, I don't remember.
Nick? I don't remember the exact time, but I do remember a conversation I had with my mom at one point where she was just like, you know, this shit ain't cheap. and there ain't some white dude that goes and gets it for you. That's all I remember that conversation. I don't think that's what actually did. I think we had had a conversation before that, mm-hmm. but I think that, like, I remember doing something that prompted that conversation. That's always stuck in my head, like, this shit ain't cheap, and some white dude don't bring it to you. My mom was real, real, like, just straightforward and funny about stuff like that. And, like, I remember laughing my butt off when she said that to me. But I know that I knew before then, but there's, yeah, it's...
I think as a kid, you keep yourself in denial for a little bit.
But there's always, like, that, like, and even like, with my kids, I don't think we actually told them, but there was always presents from Mom and Dad on the tree, and there was always one present that came from Santa. And that one present was always that one thing that they always wanted. Like, they kept talking about or whatever, and we were like, oh, we can't afford to get that for you this year, but we got you a bunch of nice stuff. And they saw the presents under the thing, and I know that they went through, like, looking to see how many tags were theirs. Like, I peeked out the door and watched them doing it, you know, and they'd be like, oh, this one's mine, this one's mine, this one's mine. And, like, then when they got up in the morning, there would be, like, two extra presents under the thing, and we'd tell them, oh, so we don't know where those came from. We always bought a different kind of wrapping paper than all the other stuff that was under there. So, like, when they look there, like, that's not the same wrapping paper. Like, we just try to make it so that they didn't really
know. It's pretty
good. And then they would be like, where'd this come from? And then they'd open it and be that one thing, and we'd always put from Santa, you know.
That's what we do with my daughter. I mean, we've always decided, okay, these are going to be the ones that are from us, these are from Santa, the ones from Santa are all getting wrapped in different paper. And then we would keep those up in our closet, and then everything else that she knows about is going underneath the tree.
Real quick, before we get to Patrick and his answer, so I'm now my eighth year of buying Christmas gifts for my daughter. And have you guys seen this new thing that the toy companies are doing where they have these, like, depending on what it is, like, they did it with these little NFL characters, these Shopkins toys. They put them in a sealed bag that you can't see what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And then you just have to, and you can't return it.
Yep.
Now, if it's $1, $2,
I have no idea what you're talking about.
That's fine. It's like, so you don't know what the toy is. Like, it could be any number of
things. It's like whenever you open a toy.
Okay, remember when you get a pack of baseball cards as a kid?
Yeah.
You didn't know what cards were in there. You just bought the pack, right?
Oh, okay.
Well, they're doing this, but with individual toys. Okay?
Well, that sucks.
My daughter loves Five Nights at Freddy's, which is a game where you play a security guard who's watching these security monitors of animatronics at a, like, a haunted Chuck E. Cheese where the animatronics are real.
I've heard about that.
My daughter is obsessed with this game and everything about it, and now they have little keychain toys that come in those packages. $7 each.
Mm-hmm.
And I bought her 10 of them, and they could be 10... they could be a fucking $70 little Chica toy keychain. That should be illegal.
My son and I, when they first started coming out with those, we were buying their little keychains, but they're Marvel figures. Mm-hmm. Same thing. And they make sure that all of them are the same, like, position.
Yep.
So that you can't feel the bag.
No.
But my son and I went through, when they first came out, they hadn't gotten to the point where they were doing this, which is what they do now. But we looked at all the things to see what the characters look like. And then we had actually become pretty proficient at like, pushing on the plastic until it made the face of whatever it was. And like, oh, that's Hulk. I don't need that. Like, oh, there's Iron Man. There's that's the one I was looking for. Now they've gotten fucking slick with it. Now they put them inside of a little plastic capsule.
Oh, yeah. So
like a little, like, capsule. Yeah, so you can only feel the fucking capsule. I'm like, well, not buying any more of those.
Well, no, you see, I actually saw somebody who tried a different system of yours. They just opened it. And I saw one, I'm like, I don't know 100% sure if she would want that character or not, so we'll let that be a gamble. Ooh, I know she wants Chica, so I'm going to go ahead and I told the girl at the register, I go, there's a couple more open, but I'm guessing, you know, parents did that. I go, so I'm going to buy this one open. And she was like, oh, all right.
But then, see, if you're at Walmart, you just walk up to you and like, look, this was open. I want a discount.
You know, I didn't even think about that.
But they want to give it to you. Right. They give it to you.
I tell you, Disney Infinity, I don't know if you guys have seen this. You probably have. Infinity, they're like, what are those other things?
Skylanders.
Yeah. They're like Skylanders where they have the characters, and they have these little discs that are like extras. They're like bonuses where you can have
special moves and abilities and buildings and all that stuff.
Buildings and cars and clothes. And in the beginning, you could take that little thing. They would sell the coasters individually in little packages just like that, and you couldn't tell what they were. So you didn't want to buy, like, if you wanted to buy 50 of them, you might have, like, half of them were all the same thing. But you could take it and put it on their display, and it would show up on the screen. But then they got slick to that, and then they changed it. I don't know how they're doing it now.
Well, you could also buy them, take them home, put them in your game, and then take the thing back and return it. Yeah, that's when they started making the foil wrapper that disrupts the signal from it. So you can't do that anymore.
Because I was doing that because we bought version, I think it's 2.0, with the Marvel, when the Marvel one came out. Mm-hmm. And I was taking the disc and putting it on there. I was like, and it wasn't, I think they had changed it by then, but I had seen on YouTube where other people were doing it. So I was like, there's a great idea. But it didn't end up working. I haven't gotten the 3.0, though, because it's all Star Wars. I want it, but she's not even playing it much anymore. So now I've just got all these Marvel characters. I've almost got them all.
Patrick, what about you? Do you remember when you found out the big guy wasn't real?
Not exactly. Just kind of.
You're like, I never saw who was in the fucking
I just found out 5 minutes ago.
Thanks a lot.
Corey, so yep. What have you been doing to celebrate the Christmas season?
Well, I don't know if how many people have seen on Facebook during October, people were saying, I'm going to do this Halloween challenge where I watch 31 horror films, one every day for the entire month of October. I tried that. I only got 30 out of 31, so I was real close. However, I thought, why not do it for Christmas? Because as we've mentioned before, I'm doing the 365 movies. In 365 days, I figured, let's end the year doing Christmas movies.
And you're just supposed to do it during December, right?
Yeah.
And how many movies have you watched so far?
Currently, today, what's today's date?
By the way, let's
today's date is the
8th.
8th. I have 5 in, so I'm 3 behind right now. But I can make that up this coming week.
Can we also point out that not one of those 5 movies is either of the movies he was supposed to
watch? Like, you had a very easy, like, 2 down. A very easy 2
yeah,
down.
Yeah, and one of them actually, I did watch, Scrooge was one of the ones that I watched. I did not watch Bad Santa, only because I was like, I'm really familiar with the movie, so I'm not going to, I didn't want to watch it. And I instead chose to watch a documentary that I really wanted to watch instead. But I'll eventually watch it.
So you've got 5 movies in the 8th day.
Yep. So I think I might actually have 6. I can't remember how many.
You know, we're getting close to the end of the year. How's that going?
Does it go to Christmas? Do you have to be done by Christmas? Mm-hmm. So you have to watch 25 movies before Christmas Day.
Mm-hmm.
You know he's going to be like, well, I mean, I could just watch 8 movies on Christmas Eve.
Right.
And it also doesn't count if you're playing it in the background as you're doing shit, you douche. I can see you watch that.
No, it was on. I'm watching the movie.
He's got one movie on here. He's got one on his monitor.
No, it's on his phone in his pocket.
There's always a loophole.
Christmas Day, it will be Christmas Story because I do watch that one.
I think they forced you to on TBS.
That's exactly how I watch it. Vic, to answer your question, for this year so far, I'm up to 246 movies.
Ooh. What was my number?
I don't remember. I've got it written down at home.
I think I was just
a little off there.
I think you were. You may have been. I think had the shorter or the least amount. I think you were at 250, and I think Vic was like at 280 or something. I think it was something like that. Or maybe.
We'll have to check it out.
Yeah. You know cool I'm about, ready to see what happens. You know what's cool about his system with this, though? I've watched 800 movies this year. We can all just say numbers.
Right. at least he's honest.
Hey, I'm pretty good at, I'm being pretty good about this, so.
No, by the way.
That's being tracked, though.
Oh,
I'm tracking it. You can find it on Letterboxd, what I've rated everything as I watched it. And let me tell you, Christmas Story 2, the sequel to... Oh, that's horrible.
There's a sequel?
Yeah, there's a sequel. We try not to mention that there's a sequel, so no one watches
it. What Christmas movie do you want to see a sequel to that hasn't been done already?
There isn't one.
Really?
Yeah.
Christmas movie that gets a sequel.
I think they're doing a Bad Santa 2.
There is a Bad Santa 2.
I mean, there's Jingle All the Way.
They're doing a sequel to that.
Are they? Oh, I heard about that. No, I heard it was Kindergarten Cop.
No, they're doing a sequel to Jingle All the Way.
Oh, no.
And, shoot. Look, give me a second. I'll see. Keep talking. I'll see if I can figure out who's in it.
I can't think of a Christmas movie that I want to necessarily see a sequel.
I wouldn't mind seeing a Grinch single.
A Grinch sequel?
You know, with Jim Carrey back as the Grinch.
You know, the only reason why I didn't think about that is because there's no such thing as a story, but it would be interesting to see an original Dr. Seuss-based story created into a movie that doesn't exist. Because there isn't a sequel to that, right? I don't think there's anything. There's nothing about the Grinch after
that.
No,
you know what would be a great would be a completely sequel, original prequel. How the Grinch becomes the Grinch. How he grows to hate Christmas.
It kind of tells you that. I
haven't seen that movie.
Yeah, it tells you. It tells you the exact reason why in the story.
But does it go through the story?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh shit!
It's amazing.
It was such a good idea.
It's a great idea, but it's they did it in the movie.
You didn't see it either, huh?
No, I've seen it. It's been a long. It's probably been about 3 Christmases since I've seen it.
This is what I was thinking as far as the sequel, Jingle All the Way. It actually came out last year, starring Larry the Cable Guy. Where's our
exactly. By the way, the Loser Game Show sound. Appreciate you stepping all over his fucking joke too. As I'm as I'm reaching to put the sound over,
I was cueing you.
Cueing. That's what you're calling it now.
Krampus. I saw Krampus, and that may be my new favorite Christmas movie. It is really good. It is really smart. It is really funny. And it is... It's dark, but it's not... It's not horror. But it is... It's very dark, especially if you can get into the mindset of being in that situation.
It's the same guy that did Trick or Treat, which I really love.
Yeah, that's a good movie. That's our Christmas movie this year. Strange as it sounds, that's what we're going to see for Christmas. The other thing, I just remembered this. Last Christmas, I'm flipping through TV, and there is I don't know what it was. I didn't actually see what the name of it was, but basically there's this chick running through the forest, and there's a Santa Claus with an axe chasing her, and she runs into the woods, which, for whatever reason, coincidentally had a wood chipper in it. She runs into the woods and ends up like hiding out right next to the wood chipper and gets pushed into it. And I just remember thinking, what the hell is this and why is it on Christmas Eve?
Speaking of wood chipper, if you ever see Silent Night, it's a horror Christmas movie. Great wood chipper scene.
Is that the one where the guy escapes from the mental hospital dressed as Santa Claus?
No.
What was that on? That was like a Tales from the Crypt movie or something like that, but there's a deranged mental patient dressed as Santa Claus.
I seem to remember something.
Yeah, like who goes and attacks this house, and there's a scene where this girl is inside of a closet, and the closet for some reason has like a window, or maybe it's a bathroom or something, and she's like freaking out, and you just see the ladder come up into the window, and you see this crazy looking Santa Claus.
Maybe that was Santa's Sleigh with Goldberg.
Santa's Sleigh was from Ernest Saves Christmas. Remember? That's the movie that the guy in Ernest Saves Christmas who's going to replace Santa Claus, that's the horror film he's doing, is Santa's Sleigh. That movie is so good. It's in your head. Subliminally. Thank you for joining us on the Showdown Holiday Celebration Spectacular episode. We want to thank our guest, Patrick the Blind Guy.
Thank you.
And, well, fellas, this is our last episode of 2015.
Holy shit, we made it pretty damn far.
I know.
Can you believe it?
Been over a year now.
So join us next time for our year in review episode. We're going to take a look back at 2015 and then maybe possibly a look ahead to some stuff in 2016. And from all of us here at the Showdown, Merry Christmas to all. And to all, a good night, my nigga.
to the Showdown Podcast, our holiday spectacular episode. It's our Patrick the Blind Guy Memorial episode.
I'm still alive.
Oh, damn it. Let's do that again. I fucked up. That you were perfect. I fucked up. I didn't think you were going to do it.
Because you were trying to, were you trying to point at him? To
I guess.
I knew it.
Okay.
So, right. Unlike Corey's last movie, he didn't catch that. He's actually blind and really up on what's happening.
Okay.
I'm still recording it.
Okay, all right.
Here we go. Dude, that's a good blooper for the end.
It is, actually. Keep that for the very... Can you do that? Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, here we go.